Good morning and welcome to the National Baptist Memorial Church. We're so grateful to have you joining us one more Sunday morning. This is the first Sunday in September in the year of our Lord 2020. And we're just glad that you are in the presence of the Lord with us this morning. For those of you that are joining us on the conference line, welcome, welcome, welcome. For those of you that are joining us streaming live with us right now, we welcome you as well. Say good morning to your brothers and sisters. Let them know that you love them. Let them know that you care. Let them know that you've been thinking about them all week long. We're so blessed and proud that you're in this space. And so I'm going to get out the way so the praise team can go ahead and take us a little higher in worship. Amen. Look, sit back, get your minds together, get focused on Jesus, because Jesus is the reason for each and every season. Amen.
Yeah.
Baptists. We really are. I'm so glad about it. I'm so glad about it. My brothers and sisters, welcome. We welcome you to the National Baptist Memorial Church, where the Spirit of the Lord dwells. Amen.
Amen.
To you, my brothers and sisters that are just now joining us, whether you're on the conference line or you're streaming with us live now, we welcome you into this place, into this space, into this opportunity of worship, to rest here, to rest right here, beyond the cross. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Let me offer you a word of prayer this morning. Merciful and everlasting God, from generation to generation, you are God. You have been our keeper. You have been our source. You have been our supply. You have been our every present need and sustainer. Thank you for being our refuge, for our very present help in times of need. Thank you for being our shield. And thank you for being our shelter. Thank you for even being our tabernacle.
Yes, yes.
We thank you, God, for the space that you make for us, for the way that you keep on providing for us, for every opportunity that you lay before us, for every door that you open, for every window that you unlatch, for every bridge that you make a way over, for every mountain that you allow us to climb. Thank you, God, for waking us up this morning, but not only that, for starting us on our way. Thank you for keeping us in our right mind, and for letting us know that this morning when we woke up and we opened up our eyes and those loving angels touched us and gently shook us woke, that we had brand new mercies. Thank you, God, for all of these mercies. Not just the mercy, but the mercies unaccounted for the mercies unnoticed, for the mercies unimagined. And now, God, be with us here in this worship opportunity. Draw close and allow us to draw closer, that we might feel you, that we might experience you, that we might hear from you. It's in Christ's name that we pray. Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Look, I'm so excited about today. Let me share something. I told you all a few weeks ago that I was going to keep on talking about something because something exciting was happening, and I was going to mention it every now and then. Well, today is that day. Guess what today is?
Today is your day?
Today, hey, there you go, man. Today is my anniversary
yeah.
with you all.
Okay.
I'm excited about that. I am so pleased, so grateful, and so excited to have been able to have this opportunity to build this dynamic family and relationship with you all. My brothers and sisters that have been walking with me, alongside of me, through things with me, out of things with me, whatever it is, we have been building a bridge together. And so we are expecting to celebrate here in this worship service, and we're hoping that you're celebrating out there in whatever manner that you need to celebrate. Amen? Amen. So there are a few things that I'm going to do out of order today, and you'll understand in just a few minutes. But I want to lift up special thoughts in each of your hearts and your minds throughout this entire service. Over this week, many folk in our family, in our extended family and in our families of families, there have been multiple tragedies, and I want to remember each of those individuals and some complications and some troubles and some trials that we've all gone through. But some of those things have been elevated and made known to me that I might pray about them with each of you. And because we are a family, you know, like I always say, I have to let you know. Because I believe that when two or three are gathered there, he'll be in the midst. And so I believe that right now, in the name of Jesus, that things are being released for each and every one of you. Amen.
Amen.
And so for any of you out there that has been struggling through something, that's been challenged by an issue, a care, concern this week, we got your back. We're praying for you, and we're praying with you. Amen.
Amen.
And with that being said, I'm going to step aside just for a second. I'm going to let the praise team take us up a little higher. And when I come back, I'm going to do an additional special prayer for those individuals. And I'm also going to do the real and relevant moment. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. I'll be right back. right there, Troy. Spiritual lesson for this morning comes from the 92nd Psalm. And it reads, "It is a good thing to give thanks unto the Lord and to sing praises unto thy name, O Most High, to show forth thy loving kindness in the morning and thy faithfulness every night. Upon an instrument of 10 strings and upon the psaltery and upon the harp with a solemn sound. For thou, Lord, hast made me glad through thy work. I will triumph in the works of thy hands. O Lord, how great are thy works, and thy thoughts are very deep." This is the word of the Lord for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Amen.
Well, look, I said that I was going to give a special prayer, and I will now. And especially for all of those individuals this past week that I've received phone calls with that have had a family member, a friend, or neighbor, or what have you, be impacted by this coronavirus, to be tested positive, to be hospitalized. Even in my family, my godmother is hospitalized and in an ICU. So we're praying for her as a family, and we ask and solicit your prayers. A few other family friends and community members that I receive phone calls with as well. I'm praying for my mother. My mother had an episode of emergent situation this week, but she is doing so much better today. She came through successfully. God's hand is yet moving, and so I'm so thankful for her recovery. And now I'm even more grateful that she is sitting down and resting somewhere. I know that she is chiming in right now, so that is for you direct. Sit down and rest a little bit. Amen. We love you. Amen. Amen. You hear the praise team? We love you. Amen. So let me pray for each and every one of you right now. I'm going to also add in a prayer for our babies that are in school, our parents that are in school, those educators that are being impacted each and every day. I'm adding all of you all in right now, because we speak to you every week, but we need to pray for you today. Amen.
Amen.
Gracious God, we need you now. We need you now more than we've ever needed you before. Some thought that they needed you in times of trouble, but many have never seen times like these before. And those that don't believe, we recognize that in a space and time like this, soon come, soon they will believe. They'll see, they'll know, they'll even proclaim and profess, just as your word says, that Jesus is the Son of God. That at the mention of your great name, all men, women, boys, and girls will lift up a resounding voice. Every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess that you are God. And so right now, while this two or three right here with me are gathered, collectively already confessing, professing, and testifying to that great name, we join together collectively to send out special prayers and special blessings upon our brothers and our sisters far and near, letting you know that God is not far from us. He is yet still near. Draw close while he might be found. bow down to His majesty, see His goodness and His loving kindness. Know that He has not forsaken you, and He will never leave any of us. And we're grateful for the comforter that is the Holy Ghost, that is still in the place, sweeping across every man, woman, boy, and girl's heart, letting each and every one of us know that we can still feel Him. We can still testify to Him. We can still know of His goodness and His grace. Protect your people, God. Protect us from every hurt, harm, and danger, from every wickedness, from every evil thing, from anything that would attempt to distract us, to trip us up, every pitfall, every stumbling block. Smooth out those roads, God, right now, in the name of Jesus. Fortify those things that need to be fortified. Place a hedge of protection around all of your children, that we might be able to testify to somebody that still needs to know a little bit more about you, that you are the way, that you are the light, that you are the truth. Shelter us, God, encamp us in your will. Let us know your power, your majesty, your goodness. We already know your kindness, and we're grateful for it. For my brothers and my sisters out there that are struggling in any way right now, bless them indeed. For my friends out there that might be struggling, bless them indeed. For my enemies out there that might be struggling, bless them indeed. For the brother and the sister that's behind me and in front of me, bless them too. Bless them as they come. Bless them as they go. Let them know that you are the truth. You are the way. You are the one to give living waters. And that through you, they won't have to worry about thirsting ever again. Receive our prayer. It's in Christ's name that we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Well, look. I said real and relevant. That's coming too. But I think we need to welcome the guests and visitors real quick. Amen. Amen. So, if we were in the sanctuary right now, we'd have our arms outstretched and we would be welcoming and speaking and high-fiving and giving hugs to and letting each and every person out there know that there's a sweet, sweet spirit in this place. There's one in here. We know there's one out there. So, praise team, here you go.
There's a sweet, sweet spirit in this place.
Two words. Thank you.
That's real and relevant, Pastor.
That's all I really have to say today. I am grateful for every blessing that God continues to give me, to show me, to direct me to the course and paths. Many of you have heard my testimony. We don't have time for all of that this morning. Amen. But what I can tell you is that I would have never thought that I would have been here. Not just here in this space, but in the place of ministry and even in the place of pastoring at any point in my life or my career. Piper mentioned this morning that she's had two full careers and that she is ready to sit down. And I can say, much like that, I've had a full career outside of the church and now inside of the church as well. And now I'm not ready to sit it down. But I have been blessed beyond measure. And when I realized that I had lost more being disobedient to God than I needed to, I got myself in line to walk in line with God. And God has shown Godself over and over and over again and proven himself to me. And with that being said, he has blessed me to have an opportunity to fellowship and be united with the National Baptist Memorial Church. And I could not be more pleased and more thankful, more grateful for not just you, but how God provides for each and every one of us. And God shows himself through our community of faith, our family of love, and how God has gifted and blessed us with a little. Talk about taking a little and making it much. We can testify at National Baptist how God does that in season and out of season. And so if you don't have anything else to be grateful for, just take this. God is worthy of your thanks and your praise. Amen? Amen. That's all for me today. Thank you again. Look, I told you this is my anniversary, so I get to sit down this week. Somewhat, because they already put me to work. You all can't see in the background. The barbecue grill is doing this thing already. and we fully intend to have a little fellowship afterwards. We are still socially distancing. Remember, out there, be mindful, be safe, be helpful. I got it upside down. See there? You got to be able to see my name. And be cautious. Y'all know me. I'm always blinged out. This one came from my mama too, right? If you're going to be out and about this weekend, you just can't help yourself. You got to get to the park or get to the beach or get somewhere because this is the last weekend technically of summer or what have you. Be safe. Be mindful. Use wisdom. Use common sense. Use the sense that God gave you. Some of y'all just need to sit down in general. Most of us. Amen. But if you just got to go, be careful. Because your life may be dependent on it. And the life of other people around you. So be mindful. With that being said, I'm so happy today that my friend, the Reverend Dr. Mark A. Jefferson, is here to deliver a word for us today. He is the Assistant Professor of Homiletics at Virginia Theological Seminary. I'm grateful to have this brother here. He has been with us several times. Whenever I call Mark just, hey, brother, you just let me know and tell me when to come. And I'm grateful to have friends like that, not just people in passing, but friends like that I can just get on the phone and say, hey, what you doing? Come on. And they get up and come because he could have been anywhere else. He preaches all over the country. Boy, it's bad. Y'all are really looking, about to experience something wonderful this morning. Amen. So after the praise team finishes this next selection, Dr. Jefferson is going to step forward and give us a word from the Lord. Amen. 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 Be blessed. I'll be back real soon. Thank you.
Pleasure to be here with you all, to be able to share with you the sweetest thing that I have, which is the Word of God. It is such an occasion to be able to worship with this fine church and this fine pastor, especially for his third anniversary, to see what God has done in this place and to see what God has done amongst the people in this place, even in a virtual setting, is exciting as I travel the country and even the world and I get a chance to preach in places near and far. It is always a particular blessing to come here and to worship with the people who hold God in high esteem and want to make his name manifest in the earth. I am the Reverend Dr. Mark Jefferson. As previously stated, I am an assistant professor of homiletics, a fancy word for preaching, at Virginia Theological Seminary. And I've been there, this will be my fourth year, and I am very glad to be there. And one of the great opportunities that I have working at Virginia Theological Seminary is that in 2023, 3 years from now or so, my seminary turns 200 years old. Quite a feat in and of itself. And in these 200 years, our seminary has gone through many travails, growths, opportunities, places for lament, places for celebration. And part of this experience is I'm going around the world, the country, even now via the TV, the computer, and the handheld gadget. I'm going to churches all around, preaching and sharing and teaching and empowering, and hopefully we are bringing joy and excitement and passion back into preaching, because it is in the preaching of the Word of God that people have grown over the years and have found sustenance for their soul. And so our contribution to that is to go out near and far and to proclaim the gospel. So I'm glad that this church is one of the stops. For the time that's ours, I'd like to share with you from a familiar passage of scripture, and it is from the book of John, the Gospel of John. And I'll be reading from chapter 11, and I'll read a few verses from there. So John chapter 11, and we'll pick up, let's pick up around verse 30. John chapter 11 and verse 30. If we were in church, I'd ask you, do you have it? If you have it, say amen. But I'm just going to assume that in your house there's a Bible somewhere. And in that, you will find John chapter 11, round about verse 30. And it reads, John had stayed outside the village at the place where Martha met him. When the people who were there at the house consoling Mary saw her leave so hastily, they assumed she was going to Lazarus's grave to weep. So they followed her there. When Mary arrived and saw Jesus, she fell down at his feet and said, "Lord, if you had only been here, my brother would not have died." When Jesus saw her weeping and saw that the other people were wailing with her, a deep anger welled within him, and he was deeply troubled. "Where have you put him?" Jesus asked them. They told him, "Lord, come and see." And Jesus wept. The people who were there standing nearby said, "See how much he loved him." But some said, "This man healed a blind man. Couldn't he have not kept Lazarus alive?" Jesus was still very angry as he arrived at the tomb, a cave with a stone rolled across its entrance. "Roll the stone aside," Jesus told them. But Martha, the dead man's sister, protested, "Lord, he has been dead 4 days. The smell will be terrible." Jesus responded, "Didn't I tell you that you would see God's glory if you believe?" So they rolled the stone aside. Then Jesus looked up to heaven and said, "Father, thank you for hearing me. You always hear me. But I said it out loud for the sake of those people standing here, so that they will believe you sent me." Then Jesus shouted, "Lazarus, come out." And the dead man came out, his hands and feet bound in grave clothes, his face wrapped in a headcloth. Jesus told them, "Unwrap him and let him go." Then Jesus shouted, "Lazarus, come out." And the dead man came out, his hands and feet bound in grave clothes, his face wrapped in headcloth. Jesus told them, "Unwrap him and let him go." For the time that's ours this morning, I'd like to share with you simply from this thought, a strange gift in a graveyard. A strange gift in a graveyard. The Gospel of John is different than the other Gospels, Mark, Luke, and Matthew, because he has a different theme in which he's writing. So John begins his important theological work in the Gospel of John by saying, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Through him were all things made, and without him nothing was made. In him was life, and that life was the light of all humankind. That light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it." We skip down a couple of verses. "The true light that gives light to everyone was coming into the world, and he was in the world, and through the world was made through him, and the world did not recognize him. He came to which was his own, but his own did not receive him. Yet to all who did receive him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God." It goes on to say, "And the Word became flesh and dwelled among us." It would seem like a strange juxtaposition to have the eternal Word, God in flesh, this manifestation of God, the highest expression of God in human form, coming down to us. But in chapter 12, this God from the cosmic sense is the God of the cemetery, the God of human finality, the God of the place that brings sorrow to the hearts of so many people. It is this Jesus who traversed the earthly trails that took him from his place of birth. And now as he is heading toward Jerusalem, the Gospel of John follows this path as he goes from miracle to miracle and place to place. And now this eternal in flesh manifestation of God is now in a struggle with humans who are struggling with death. It doesn't seem fair. It doesn't even seem right that us human beings who strive so hard to live a godly life and do the best we can to manifest God's goodness in the earth, for us to have to then also be subject to the same powers of death that grab those who are not necessarily believers in God. It is this uncertainty, it's this tension that we feel when we go through life and we see and we look around and we see the frustration and the pain, yet we are asking, where is our God? It is this question, this piercing, penetrating question that arrests Martha and Mary. For in chapter 11, they send Jesus a message. That message simply says, Jesus, come quick, because Lazarus, the one that you love, he's very, very sick. Receiving this message, Jesus does something strange. He lingers a little while longer instead of making haste to the place. This adds to the confusion as disciples are wondering, what is Jesus up to? How can the Jesus who knows our thoughts from afar off, how can this Jesus who can read minds and perceive the hearts of individuals receive a direct supplication from people who love him the most, yet he lingers in his response? Maybe this uncomfortable seat of existential conditioning is where you find yourself. Maybe you've made your petition known to God. God, please save my family. God, please intervene in my circumstances. God, you see what I'm going through and you see how I'm having to wrestle. God, if you are who you say you are, I'm asking you on the strength of our relationship to show up and show yourself strong. But it seems like God is lingering. It seems that unemployment continues to stretch itself out. It seems as if sickness continues to protract itself out. It seems as if uncertainty has continued to extend itself beyond our ability to contain it. And so now we are turning over our supplications to the only one who we know that can do something about it. So it is in this lingering that Jesus is setting up something greater. He's lingering because he says, if you wanted to see the glory of God manifest, then you're going to have to go through the difficulty of the wait. If you want to see God bring about the miraculous in ways in which that the human can't even comprehend, if you're going to bring these things about, you must have the endurance and the patience to wait. But this waiting seems to be even more frustrating because as Jesus lingers, Lazarus' situation deteriorates. So by the time Jesus actually arrives on the scene, by the time that Jesus makes his presence felt, Lazarus has died. Now, what kind of testimony would this be for Jesus to love Mary and to love Martha and to love Lazarus, yet Lazarus' life has ended? It seems a cruel twist of irony for those who have given Jesus habitation and given Jesus comfort and given Jesus hospitality, for them to find that hospitality is seemingly being returned to them in silence. So when Jesus manifests on the scene, when Jesus shows up in Bethany, it's a strange and difficult scene because Mary and Martha are wrestling with the death of their brother. Mourners have come and descended upon the house of Mary and Martha. And these women are struggling with this new reality of their dead brother in different ways. So as Jesus seemingly saunters into the situation, Martha says, Lord, if you would have only been here, Lazarus would not have died. A few verses later, Mary says the same thing. Out of their grief, they are stating the fact. Jesus, if you would have been here, you would have staved off the powers of death from gripping our brother. If you would have been on time, as if when we called you, you could have done what we asked you to do. This feeling is human. This feeling is right. But this feeling is not the full extent of what God is after. So Jesus, playing the outskirts of the village, hanging out on the outskirts of the village, he is being moved by the compassion of seeing other people mourning. And he's moved to the place in which even Jesus wept. It seems strange that the Almighty God would be so moved by the frustrations of his earthbound creations that he would still enter into a space of deep mourning with us and for us. That's good news to me to know that I have a God that not only superintends and not only dwells amongst, but a God that cries with. Some of us, life has not been a crystal stair. We've faced frustration and sadness and sorrow and anger and disappointment, and it seemed as if our neighbor to the left and our friend to the right was uninterested in our pleas. But to know that there is a God that is moved by our deep frustrations, that gives us the strength to hold on and to manifest God's goodness one more day. So this deep feeling of frustration and deep feeling of pain that moved Jesus to cry at the tomb of Lazarus, this feeling is not just a feeling of empathy, but it's also one that leads to action. Because Jesus then tells the people, I have something for you to do. I need you to roll away the stone on this dead thing. I want you to remove the covering from this area of something that has faced necrosis and now is on the other side of life's productive patterns. And now this person that you love, that you have put away, I'm asking you to uncover that so that you can see God at work. But actually, if I'm allowed to be honest with you today, one of my favorite and strangest and kind of funniest passages of the Bible is nestled in this text. If you read it in the King James, Martha tells Jesus, look, if we roll this stone away, it's gonna stink. In the King James, it says comically, it stinketh. It lets you know that the process of rigor mortis and necrosis have begun to do their work on this body. And so if there's anything to be done, it is almost too late, because the smell gives you the indication that something is awry. But I appreciate Martha's honesty here, because if we're allowed to be honest today, there's some things in our lives that stink. If we're allowed to look at the body politic of our nation, this body stinketh. On one side, you have a group of people trying to maintain the status quo. And then on the other side, you have a group of people who are saying, vote for me so I can maintain the status quo. It seems that whether you're on the left, the right, the center, or on the fringes, we're all part of this large game in which very few people seem to come out on top. It seems as if our body politic stinketh. When we turn on the news or open our phones or read the newspaper, we find that we're always living in the midst of one trial or one controversy or one bad bill or one amendment that should have been passed or one decision or one war that's going to send us over the edge and to the point in which we find ourselves saying, it stinketh, Lord. You really can't do anything with this. Our nation is too far gone. Maybe there's a relationship in your life and you're saying, God, I have it covered up. I put a stone in front of it. It's dead to me. And Jesus is saying, remove the stone. And you're saying, God, it stinketh. I don't have a relationship with my mother or my father or my friend anymore, because this season has been so difficult on us that it's broken us apart. But could it be that Jesus is inviting you to move the stone away from that thing that you've been hiding? Yes, it stinks. Yes, it is noxious to the nostrils. But at the same time, it's this same God who is promising something more than the pain that you experience. And if we're also allowed to be honest, this COVID time, this pandemic, has placed many of us in a situation where we are saying it stinketh. I'm sitting in my house every day, looking at the same walls every day, talking to the same people every day, talking to myself every day. I can't travel. I can't even sing in church. It stinks, Lord. I'm tired of life not being what it should be, and I'm just dealing with the reality of the death of the situation. Lord, I've had people die this year. Lord, I've had people go through illness this year. Lord, I've lost my job this year. This year stinks. But I love the fact that Jesus is not dissuaded by her honesty, because he understands that though her truth is her truth will not be the overarching truth by the time it's over. So they remove the stone away, And Jesus being the incarnate word that we just experienced in John chapter 1. In the beginning was the Word. And the Word was with God. And the Word was God. And through this Word was all things made. And whatever was made through this Word. So when this Word began to speak, it's amazing how the body began to regenerate itself and the cells began to reverse the processes of death and decay. And all of a sudden, it was quiet in that cave. And from that quietness came the creaking of a dead man. The Word invigorated the situation, changed the aspects and the dynamics of what's going on so that life could be possible. But I titled the sermon, A Strange Gift from the Graveyard. Why is that? Because the gift at the graveyard was found at the end of this text. Lazarus, this dead man, this dead thing, this dead body that went through the processes of death and almost had to find himself living again in a strange new world. It is in this process that we find Lazarus, but Jesus says, unwrap him and let him go. Lazarus, this dead thing, has now become a strange gift from the cemetery because it is our job to unwrap and liberate the possibility of what can be. Jesus has done his part. God has done God's part. But the question now becomes, what is our responsibility in the liberation and the freedom of our possibilities? Yes, God can awake things. Yes, God can invigorate things. Yes, God can call things that weren't and call them into being. But today, before us, is the opportunity to meet God where God is working. For us to unwrap those dead things and give them a chance to flourish and live again. My sister and my brother, this year might stink. My sister and my brother, these relationships that we've engaged in might stink. Our economic situation might stink. Our political situation might stink. But we still have the opportunity to take off the death clothes and speak and grant life to those things. This message today is for those who have been through the struggle and they're sitting down and they're reflecting about what God has done and they're reflecting about where God has taken them and they're thinking about the struggles that they've had to go through and as tears run down your face and you see how far God has brought you. God has brought you this far so that you can then take off the death clothes around the possibilities in your life. As African Americans, God is inviting us to take more agency. God is inviting us to stand up and be counted. As Christians, God is asking us to stand up and be accounted for. In a world that claims is stumbling in darkness, the light that lights all people is shining through us as well. I hope each and every one of you respond to God's strange gift in the cemetery. The opportunity for us to unmask death and to shine light upon our possibilities. May the Lord bless you. May the Lord keep you. May the Lord cause God's face to shine upon you. Amen.
Brothers and sisters, what a powerful word that we heard this morning. That in our spaces of gloom and despair, when things are stinking all around us, we just in some mess, some messiness and some messy places, we recognize for sure that our God is a rose, the rose of Sharon. And the lily of the valley, that there's a sweet fragrance that's coming from. Amen? And that there's nothing better than the bloom of fresh perfume and incense. Yes. Even that of that fragrant oil that Mary poured at the feet of Jesus. none of us knows the cost of the oil in our alabaster. Jar, you don't know and I don't know, but what we do know is that at the end of the story, that we still win. Amen? We're thankful for the blessing, for the giftedness of the word, of the study, of the preparation of the Reverend Dr. Mark Jefferson. And we ask God right now to pour back into him richly everything that he poured out, that he came to give, and that he gave, and he gave well, that he dissected, that he chopped up, that he broke it down, and he gave it to us again where we needed it. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. We never want to leave this place or this space, my brothers and sisters, without offering you an opportunity to accept the Lord Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. If you are out there right now and you recognize that you are living in some stinky situations, and even the situations that you're living in, some of them you cause, maybe most of them you cause. You're sitting in the midst of your filth, your messy stuff, and you can't even recycle it right now. You can't compost it. There's nothing that you can do with it. It's just nasty. If you're ready to shake it off, wash it off, and you're ready to plunge deep down into the fountain of living waters to be replenished, to be cleansed. So my brothers and my sisters, we offer Christ to you today. We offer Christ to you. If that's you out there this morning and you recognize it, say this prayer with me. God, I love you and I adore you. I bless your holy name. I'm a sinner. I'm a wretch. I have been living in filthy, stinking situations too long, and I'm ready to get through it. I'm ready to get over it. I'm ready to cast it aside. So right now, clean me up. Make me new. Purge me that I might be white as snow. It's me, God. It's me. The preacher was talking to me this morning. And so right now, I yield. I yield. I yield to your way. I yield to your words. I want you to come in right now, Lord, please. Clean up my heart. I confess that I have been wrong many times before. But today, I recognize Jesus as the Son of the living God. I know that he bled, died for my sins, and that he is seated on the right hand of the Father with all power in his hand. So right now, God, make me new. I believe that you are the one true living God. If you've prayed that prayer with us today, we believe that you've been redeemed, that you've been healed, that you've been delivered, that you've been set free, that you've been saved. Yes. If that is you, my brothers and sisters, reach out to us. Let us know that that was you this morning. Stay connected here so that we can connect with you in prayer and fellowship, that we can keep you covered. That if you live somewhere far, that we can make sure that you are joined with the Bible-based serving, giving, fellowshipping kind of community wherever you are. But until then, stay connected to us right here. Amen. Once again, we give thanks to Mark Jefferson, the doctor, the Reverend Dr. Mark A. Jefferson, for his gift of God's word to us today. Amen. Amen. Now look, it's time. It's time for our communion. Amen. So I'm going to ask Dr. Jefferson to come back up. I'll come back with the offering. I'll come back with the offering. You have time right now to get your offering together. Matter of fact, I'm stalling for a second just so that I can give each of you an opportunity to run and grab some juice real quick and the cracker, a piece of bread or something. So we're stalling real quick. So we're going to let the praise team sing. One quick verse of Just For Me. By that time, you should have your cracker, your juice, your bread, because I forgot to tell you. Remember, this is first Sunday of September. So they're going to sing one verse. Hurry up. Come on. There we go. All right.
Just for me.
for me.
It seems strange that on the night in which Jesus would be betrayed, that he would take some time out with friends and even a foe and break a little bread and drink a little wine. It seems kind of small that we would break off a couple of pieces of bread to show that the broken body of Christ has been broken apart for us. It seems a little trivial sometimes that the blood that we symbolize with the cup we take so quickly, but it is these deep symbols that connects us to Christians throughout the ages. Whether they were hungry Christians or full Christians, homeless or housed, it is these simple elements, cracker and juice, bread and wine, whatever elements that you have on hand, they reflect the humbleness and the sincerity of the faith. Gone are the fancy cathedrals and the shimmering buildings. And now we are here with the elements. Jesus took this bread that represents his body, a body that was broken for us, broken by capital punishment, broken by an unjust court system, broken by friends who turned their back. This body that was broken not just by an aggressive military force, but broken by the choices of the society as a whole. It is this body that we are sharing today. My sister, my brother, it is this cup, the blood of Jesus, our sacrificial lamb, our atoning sacrifice. It is this blood that was drained from his forehead and from his back and from his thighs and from his arms as he was beaten, hung by systems that sought to dismember his being. It is this blood that is precious. And it's this memory that holds us tight. So as you take your bread and as you take your cup, hold these things in your hand, knowing that God has blessed them for this occasion. So if you would take your piece of bread, my sister, my brother. The body of our Lord Jesus Christ, accept it and receive it into everlasting life. My sister and my brother, the cup signifies the blood of Jesus Christ. Drink this into everlasting life. Elements, we receive and accept the joy that's been given to us. Know that you've been forgiven. Know that you've been called. Now that you're empowered to do the work, be great.
Just for me.
Anybody glad about that?
Glad about it.
Just for you and just for me. You did all of that. All of that just for you and just for me. That's all right, right there. Look, it's that time. Get your offering in your hand, your best gift. Get your best gift in your hand right now. Wherever you are, grab that gift as we transition and we get ready to consecrate it and bless it, give it back to God, amen. So whatever you have, even if you don't have anything, you're down in your way right now and you're just waiting for the next move. We believe that God will reward your heart and your faithfulness. So even then, just hold your hand up wherever you are. Wherever you are, just hold a hand up. And right where you are, pray this prayer with us. God, we love you, we adore you, we bless your holy name. Look down on these gifts that we're bringing cheerfully with a smile on our face and open heart. And we say thank you for what you've given us. We give back a little to you, just a little, because we know that we can't beat God's giving no matter how hard we try. And so we thank you, God, right now for these gifts. It's in Christ's name we pray, amen. Even though I've already done that, I'm gonna get the praise team to go ahead and do the doxology for us real quick, all right? All right? All right, amen. And I'm not gonna move. I'm gonna sit right here.
God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
One announcement, and then I'm going to ask Dr. Jefferson to come back and give us the benediction. Amen?
Amen.
Here's the announcement. Bible study, we are on break until October, the first Wednesday in October. Bible study has been absolutely dynamic. And so for those of you that have just been kind of getting your mind wrapped around picking up something else on a Wednesday, even though you're staying at home, you really should do this, because we're probably going to be home for a little while longer anyway, and you might as well get into God in the midst of this. Amen. So those of you that have been in Bible study with me every week, walking through all of these lessons, call somebody and let them know how good it is. Let them know how much fun you've been having, and let them know, encourage them to come on. Y'all see all this gray hair on my face?
I don't see none of it.
I cut all of my beard off, and now it's growing back all gray. And I don't even understand.
That's
what, I mean, like, it's wisdom or something, but it's coming back. I mean, just all gray. Oh, wow. Look at that. Amazing. I'm still handsome.
Oh, pandemic wisdom.
But look, the smoker is going. Y'all can't smell it and y'all can't see it, but it smells good up in here. And so good. And so we are so ready. You all have been a blessing as always. And I hope that you received a blessing from this message and even especially the sermon that was delivered today. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Look, I love you. And there is nothing that you can do about it. Here comes Dr. Jefferson. I'll see you here same time next week.
I want to thank you all for allowing me to worship with you. It has been my distinct pleasure to worship with such an amazing band and praise team. Dr. Collins is one of my close friends, and to worship with each of you again in this way makes my heart glad. God, you've been so good to us.
Yes.
You've seen us through highs, you carried us out of lows. You've shown us today that though it stinks, we have the responsibility and the opportunity to take off the death clothes and to make life abundant. Keep us, Lord. Hold us, Lord. Allow us to know that our future is secured in your hands. May the Lord bless you and keep you. cause God's face to shine upon you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you. And may the Lord grant you peace. We ask this in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Thank you very much. Love you much.
Every now and then, but life comes down to two things, and that's acceptance and rejection.